Wow, we're live. Yes, we are. All right. So today we're going to be doing an A push review. The pace is going to be a lot faster than usual because I know people like it if we speed things up a little bit. It just helps our viewers. So right off, we're going to start off with the disclaimer. So I, Rahul Nayak,
and I, Josh Siskind,
founders of Swag Test Prep, do not condone the act of cheating on any assignment in any way. The sole intention of this broadcast is to help our viewers that need additional assistance in AP US history. This broadcast is for educational purposes only and not for forging assignments.
We strongly encourage the use of this broadcast to help assist you with the completion of the assignment and as a test review, but at the same time strongly urge you to do additional reading and research as this will only result in your benefit. Thanks for tuning in.
And we hope that you enjoy this broadcast. All right. So, we're going to start off with an overview of the chapter. So, the chapter...
Before we do, we'd like to thank Jack Aluntowitz for tuning in.
Yep. So, the chapter today, or that we'll be discussing, is in our book, it's chapter 30. It's Wilsonian Progressivism and at Home and Abroad. This time period is between 1912... 1916 is basically right after Wilson gets elected as president until he reruns for election and then proceeding into like World War One. All right, so let's talk about the election of 1912. Election of 1912, there are a couple people running. First, you have Theodore Roosevelt, you have Woodrow Wilson, you have Taft, and you also have the socialist candidate. Josh, you remember the socialist candidate?
Eugene V. Debs, who was also the hero of the Pullman strike.
Yeah, so the election, so Wilson, he was running as a Democrat. Initially, Theodore Roosevelt wanted to run as the Republican candidate, but as we know, Taft sort of hacked for himself at the Republican convention. He got nominated. Therefore, Roosevelt created his own political party called the Bull Moose Party, and also ran under a progressive platform. Then Debs, the socialist candidate, he also had his own platform, but what the election basically came down to was Taft and Roosevelt. So as we know, since Roosevelt was originally a Republican and Taft was the current Republican president, the Republican vote was split. Therefore, when the election results came, originally it looked like Roosevelt was going to win, but what happened was Wilson ended up winning because he was Democratic, and the Republican votes were split between Roosevelt and Taft. So when that split, you have Wilson, he was actually a minority president. A minority president is someone that gets less than half of the popular vote and still wins the election because they win each state in terms of electoral votes. So Wilson had the most electoral votes, but did not have a majority of the popular vote. And this actually, this election of 1912 was really big for the socialist candidate, Debs, because even though they didn't get a single electoral vote, so none of the states on the map was colored in a socialist color, they managed to get 900,000 popular votes, which was actually... really, really big deal for them. Socialism was at a peak in 1912, and even though they had really no chance of winning, it's really big accomplishment. So it's important to keep in mind that this election, like, even though Taft was still a Republican progressive, he didn't really play a big role. It really came down to Roosevelt and Wilson. So they both were running on progressive platforms. Roosevelt's platform was called New Nationalism, and Wilson's platform was called New Freedom. So
they were both progressive, by the way.
Yes, yeah. So they each had different progressive methods. Like, even though they were under the same umbrella, they had different ways about approaching it. So Roosevelt approached it from author Robert Crowley's, like, idea of progressivism. He is one of the people that Roosevelt, like, read and really thought had correct ideas. So what Roosevelt believed was that he said that the consolidation of industry was going to happen. Like, there's no way we could prevent this. Everyone, a lot of trusts are going to combine. There's going to be the growth of business. There's no way we can prevent this. Therefore, it would be stupid for us to like actually get involved and try to stop it.
That meant bad business, of course.
Yeah, so that meant that Roosevelt said that the government should increase their size to compete with these growing businesses. This is one area where Wilson and Roosevelt sort of really conflicted. As we'll get into Wilson a little bit later, Wilson wanted government to maintain a small size and just eliminate all trusts. But in addition, Roosevelt was also going under his idea of like getting rid of the bad trusts and keeping the good trusts. So he was under the whole idea of regulating trusts rather than what Wilson. So Wilson, as I mentioned earlier, was running under New Freedom. This platform was that business is bad. Business is bad because it doesn't. Yeah, big business is bad because it doesn't help the consumer. He was really looking towards the individual consumers that were sort of being robbed because these big businesses had this monopolies and like having like these price adjustments, right? So New Freedom, his platform, said that regardless of the trust, it was government's job to break them up. Didn't matter if they were good, didn't matter if they were bad, you just had to break them up. And this was because the trust hurts the little guys or the consumers. And additionally, as I mentioned before, he wanted to downsize government. He didn't want to do what Roosevelt was doing to make it bigger to match with big business. And this is because he said that another thing he said during his election was that Roosevelt was going to partner with big business in the future. So that was another thing that really helped him win, is because he said that Roosevelt, because he wants to increase the size of government in order to match with these big businesses, he would eventually partner with big business in his like during his presidency. So all these voters were looking to Wilson as someone that would eliminate all trusts and do them good because they were the consumers that didn't have the money. And then the only job that Wilson said government would have, like primary job, was to eliminate and punish these trusts, whereas Roosevelt wanted to like make multiple branches of government to do multiple different things. That was another area that they sort of disagreed on, right? So what another thing Roosevelt was running on was social welfare. Social welfare examples are minimum wage laws, like insurance, life insurance, worker insurance. This is something that a lot of workers liked. Another thing that Roosevelt was running on was women's suffrage. Women's suffrage was an area not touched at
all. Roosevelt was running on social reforms in general but Wilson didn't believe in that, the main difference between them.
Another social area was women's suffrage. Roosevelt was a big player in wanting women's suffrage, whereas Wilson did not really touch the issue. So Wilson, his idea was also a laissez-faire government, which is like small government, a little bit hands-off, and like consumers and businesses. Their only job, the government, was to get rid of the business, big business. So Roosevelt, as I said, wants to make the government where different parts of the government do different things. And Wilson, on the other hand, says that the government needs to ensure that all businesses and all people get to start at the same time and get to start at the same place. So there is no like point where someone would have too big of an advantage, someone would have too less of an advantage. He wanted to be an even playing field for all businesses, for all consumers, and everyone would get to also be ensured that everyone would stay in their own lanes, and there would be no cheating, I guess, in the system to like change this. Another big issue was in Congress. Wilson needed Congress because he was a president. Congress needed Wilson because Wilson was a president. So what happened was that Congress, instead of like I think it was Jefferson who started the practice of like sending letters to Congress based on like what he wanted to happen, what he wanted Congress to do, Wilson took a different approach. As we know, he's a really good speaker because of his past. He actually changed the practice to giving speeches to Congress in order to pass these future laws and like to tell them what he wanted to oversee. But the problem was Wilson was an idealist. What is an idealist? An idealist is someone that like thinks or of their ideas to be like the best, or someone that thinks that what they're doing is the best idea. So as you can
Wilson
see,
Wilson was very arrogant because of that.
Those two things added together makes him unable to compromise. This would lead to many issues, because if you're the president, one of the things you have to be able to do is compromise. If you can't compromise, there's no way that you can actually achieve anything, because it's not, you can't expect the entire country to agree with just what you said. Another thing that happened, overview, was that Wilson said that he needed to do well his first term in order to make sure he was elected the second term. He was a little bit like uneasy because he realized that the only reason he had been elected was because of the split in the Republican vote to Roosevelt and Taft. He said that he needed to do well in order to secure his position for the second term. So let's talk about, in terms of like tariffs, what he passed. Wilson passed the Underwood-Simmons tariff in 1913. It was a pretty big revision because it really, really lowered tariff rates. So low tariff means more more foreign business. More foreign business means more competition among business in America. More competition means lower price, and lower price means consumers happy. Consumer happy means businesses sad. So Wilson was looking to the people. On the other hand, another way to look at this is a high tariff means the foreign businesses will stay out. If foreign businesses stay out, there'll be a lot less competition. If there's a lot less competition, this will lead to monopolies and creating really high prices. High prices means consumers are sad. Consumers are sad, but big businesses will be happy. That chain is not what Wilson wanted, so he looked to the previous one where consumers were happy in the end. Okay, so this tariff was the first tariff that it, like, included federal income tax, like the 16th Amendment, which was that like there would be a graduated income tax or progressive income tax.
This was actually passed shortly after the 16th Amendment, because the 16th Amendment was passed just before Wilson took office.
Yeah, so this actually made the progressives really happy, because they realized if they weren't rich, they would be paying a lot different price than the people that were really rich. This would eventually benefit the entire system, benefit the poor. The rich would have to just pay more, but he wasn't really catering to the rich, so this was a good idea from a progressive mindset. So the big point of the 16th Amendment was they were not playing equal proportions. Everyone wasn't playing equal proportions. And what the Underwood-Simmons tariff did was that it lowered the tariff rate that they had to pay. And in order to ensure that they would still make profit, by even after they lowered the tariff rate, the 16th Amendment was there to ensure that they would be getting like income tax, right? And income tax is something we still use today, started back then. We're still using it. It's still helping us as a nation. Then there was the lobbyists, right? Josh, you want to talk about lobbyists?
All right, the lobbyists, they still exist today, but they really got their main push and startup during this era. What they were, there were a bunch of people representing industry, and they would essentially bribe congressmen by taking them out to like sporting events or whatever, taking them to like fancy restaurants, and telling them to add things to the bill. So, for example, for the Underwood tariff, there'd be like people from the orange industry would be like, yo, put the orange on the tariff list to protect our company. So they kind of got a hold of the bill and made it not exactly what Wilson wanted.
Yes. Okay, so now let's talk about banking, right? So the shortfall during the time was the inelasticity of currency. What this means is like there was no standard practice of how people would pay for things. Like the dollar wasn't fully there. Neither was like the gold backed currency. There was no like equalized way that everyone would be able to buy. So there was the Aldrich Commission. This discussed that we needed a third national bank. But then there was the Pujo Commission, which came up with the idea of like money trusts. Like they talked about like money trusts, where like how like few rich people were actually more powerful than the president just because of their money. But what the Pujo Commission came up with was the Federal Reserve Act. The Federal Reserve Act had many implications. Firstly, it was meant to reform the nation's money system. One, it set up the Federal Reserve Board. Federal Reserve Board members were appointed by the president, president only, so this would ensure that it was completely fair and not biased. And then it also oversees 12 regional banks. So rather than having a third national bank, they had 12 regional banks, each of which was privately owned, spread out over a wide area. This would was hoped to create the best impact of for the country. Also, when ordered to, the Federal Reserve Board could issue federal bank notes, Federal Reserve notes, whenever they wanted. This was not something that would be done by Congress. It would be done by the Federal Reserve Board in order to be the best decision. Then let's talk about trusts. So in 1914, the Federal Trade Commission Act was basically a way to crush monopolies. It wanted to get rid of unfair business practices, unlawful competition, false advertising, mislabeling of products, and bribery. So all of this together, it was an effort to eliminate these trusts, progressive era, progressivism, another way to do that. Then also in 1914, there was a Clayton Antitrust Act. This basically just increased the list of objectionable business practices that were listed in the Sherman Antitrust Act. It added interlocking directories. What are interlocking directories, you might ask? They were
when companies who weren't officially on paper incorporated or together, but they had share information about prices and they worked together to charge high prices. Another thing about the Clayton Antitrust Act is that it did not attack trust in agriculture, like with farmers, and it did not attack labor unions.
Exactly. Another thing it talked about was price discrimination. Price discrimination was that, like, different people would get different prices based on, like, the services or, like, the amount of time that they were, the connections they had, stuff like that. That they it said was bad. There's no actual way to regulate these two things because, like, you could just be like, oh, it was a coincidence. We had the same price. Or, oh, like, we actually didn't charge them this much. Like, there's no way to actually do this. But by trying to put it down on paper, they tried to somehow stop it or slow it down or somehow impact it. So this Clayton Antitrust Act of 1914 was known as the Magna Carta of labor just because it had a really big impact. And as Josh mentioned, it didn't affect farm and labor because they weren't really trusts. Okay, then Josh, you want to talk about the Federal Farm Loan Act and the Warehouse Act?
All right, the Federal Farm Loan Act, all that did was allow low credit interest loans to farmers to force the banks to give it to them because the bankers didn't really want to because farmers were poor and didn't have a lot of money, but this made them have to do that. And the Warehouse Act was basically said that even if farmers didn't have money to pay back a loan, but they had a bunch of wheat, they could go to the bank and be like, yo, I know I don't have money right now to pay you back, but I will be able to pay you back because of this wheat that I have. So the Warehouse Act said that farmers could do that, which is a big advantage to them. Before that, they needed money up front, not money in crops, which is only theoretical money.
Okay. So you got both of those, right, Josh?
Yeah.
All right, so the La Follette-Siemens Act was basically a way to ensure better wages for people working overseas on the ocean, and it was a way to treat sailors better. As we know, or maybe you don't know, but the conditions on ships at the time were very unregulated. Nobody actually, sort of like in factories, there's no like actual way to improve them on the ship at sea. There was terrible conditions for everyone. If you were a worker, you were not really respected and put in terrible working situations. And La Follette-Siemens Act saw through this and made sure that it was improved, or at least did a little bit to try and improve it. Then there's a Workmen's Act, and it said that like if you work for the government, then and something happened to you, then you would be like helped in that case.
That's just like disability leave, so
Yeah.
I'd still get paid if I'm out for work for 2 weeks or 2 months in a wheelchair.
Exactly. So that was another way to improve the way people were treated in the system. Then was the Adamson Act, where the interstate commerce, if you worked in interstate commerce, your working hours would be 8 hours, and if you worked anything more than 8 hours, you'd be paid extra wages. So that's where like the whole extra hour idea comes from. Work more, get paid more, but you only had to work 8 hours. This ensured that everyone was treated fairly, had the same conditions, and just helped. Okay, then that was a basic overview, I guess, of the chapter. There's a little bit more. It goes into World War I, how we joined, how, why we joined, and then like the outcomes. But before we get into that, we're just going to talk about the work directly from the packet. If we have any questions, you want us to stop talk about it differently, just
Yeah,
like we just
about
asked.
that. Before we get to the packet, I know it's not on the section, but real quick, I had a request to talk about the Peer Food and Drug Act that was passed under Roosevelt, partially in response to the book The Jungle by Upton Sinclair, and perfecting the doctoring / adultering of food and drugs.
Okay. All right. So if we look at question one, it says, explain the difference between Roosevelt's form of progressivism and Wilson's form of progressivism. So we already talked about this, but they disagreed. Well, they were both progressives. They disagreed on little things like the government's involvement. So as we know, Roosevelt said more government involvement because business is growing, so government needs to grow. Wilson said, smaller government, get rid of all big business because they're all bad. They all don't help the consumer. Get rid of them. Let's see, is there anything more? Yeah, so Roosevelt's was called New Nationalism. Wilson's was called New Freedom. That's very important. That's how they titled them. That's how they differentiated. They're both aiming to achieve newer things. Then Roosevelt talked more about like social issues, women's suffrage, minimum wage law, labor unions, stuff like that. And Wilson didn't really touch on those issues. It didn't really hurt him too much, but he just steered away. So Bull Moose for the nose. Bull Moose was the name of Roosevelt's party that he ran under. New Nationalism was Roosevelt's. New Freedom was Wilson's. Josh, you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, they got the name Bull Moose because Roosevelt, in a speech in Kansas, I think it was. No, that was the difference. Whatever. He used to say that he was as strong as a bull moose, and that name kind of struck. All right, so Woodrow Wilson, a minority president. The 1912 election results are fascinating, and that is for a number of reasons. One, because after the election, for the first time, pretty much since 1860, Republicans were a minority party, which was uncharted territory for them because up to then they have dominated the whole political scene. It was also fascinating because there were more Republican votes for Taft and Roosevelt combined than there were for Wilson, but because the Republicans are split, they didn't win. There's more socialist votes. There was the peak of socialism. Teddy Roosevelt was a third-party candidate, yet he received the second most votes. Progressivism won because if you add Wilson and Roosevelt's results together, the two progressive, real progressives, it's a staggering amount of money, or a staggering amount of votes, rather. And Wilson only won 41% of the popular vote, but thanks to the splitting of the Republican Party, he won. So that's some of the fascinating parts of the 1912 election. So, Rahul, do you want to talk more about how Wilson's a political idealist?
Yeah, so that would be question number three. Question three says, how did Wilson's personality and past affect the way he conducted himself as a president? So, as we know, he was born in the South, so he sided with the Confederates during the Civil War. He was the son of a Presbyterian minister, so that sort of like evolved his opinions on things. And it was like he was brought up in a religious setting as a child, sort of shaped all his like future ambitions. And in public, he was very cold and like standoffish, so he wasn't very an avid participant. But in private, he was different. So in private, he was very like active. Then his academic background made him agree with scholars. And it's funny, he didn't really like stupid people. So anyone that was like below intelligent of his level, he would consider them to be inferior, not like their opinion, not agree with it, regardless of what it was, just completely like turn them down.
And he was pretty intellectually advanced because he was the school president of Princeton University.
Yeah. And as we talked about, he is very stubborn, didn't like compromising. That's bad for a president because a president needs to compromise. There's no way they can like get on without doing that. Okay. So, let's see. Oh, yeah. So he had this thing called like self-determination. And he was very good at writing speeches and giving speeches. He was a very motivational speaker. He was able to captivate an audience, get them to listen, get them to agree with him, even though what he was saying, they might not have agreed with. They just like liked his tone of voice, and that persuaded them to agree with his decisions. So that's another thing that helped him win the election. So, Josh, want to do the next one?
Yeah. All right. So Wilson had this triple wall of privilege called tariff, banks, and trust. Those were the three things he really tried to get after, and he did a quite a good job of getting after and abolishing them in his first term. First off, he needed to get rid of the tariff, which was the Underwood tariff, which dramatically lowered the tariff, which increased foreign participation in the market, to increase competition. Good for the little guys, good for the everyday people, not necessarily big business, which he wanted, which also helped take out the trust. So it kind of did both. And it also acted on the 16th Amendment and acted a federal income tax. And not long after the Underwood Tariff, I think like 10 years, the United States made more revenue from the income tax than from the tariff, which is more aligned with what we have today, because we don't really have tariffs, we just have income tax. That's pretty much it. Want to talk about how he battles the second component, banks?
Yeah, let's talk about some banks. How is the Federal Reserve System different than the banking system that existed in the U.S. in 1913? So we already went into this pretty in-depth before, but it set up 12 regional reserve districts, each with their own central bank, had paper money. These regional banks were, the 12 of them were all privately owned, different areas spread out, more people could access them. And then the Federal Reserve Act also had enacted the Federal Reserve Commission, right? And the Federal Reserve Board. Federal Reserve Board was appointed by the president. They basically were like a group of people that were completely unbiased. They made the decisions. And when ordered to, the Federal Reserve Board could issue Federal Reserve notes, and this was mandated by the Federal Reserve Board, not Congress. It was something to keep them out. And yeah, so that would be the issue with banks. Let's see, hold on one second. So that answers the question. Banks were a really big issue because before this, the system was not very stable. It was very iffy. They wanted to create like a more national banks. That wasn't Wilson's idea, so he went with this 12 regional bank deal. That really helped them actually sort of improve things. Okay. Next question, Josh.
Alrighty, so the third point, taming the trust, as we mentioned, he was a complete trust buster. He busted everything in sight, didn't make a distinction between good and bad. His philosophy was, it's big, then it's bad. He used the Federal Trade Commission Act, which gave more authority to curb illegal trade, or not legal, but big trust, taboo business action. And the Clayton Antitrust Act, we covered in extensively earlier, so you can go back and watch it. And just a reminder, anytime you want, you can go, reopen this link, a couple of days, a year from now, 2 years from now.
During the AP exam.
Don't do that, because that's cheating, but...
No, not during the, like, when you're prepping for the AP.
Oh, I meant during. All right.
Yeah.
All right.
All right, you took care of that one?
Yeah.
All right, let's talk about Wilsonian progressive at high tide. Describe some of the positive and negative outcomes of Wilson's progressive legislation actions. So, different acts helped farmers, especially the Federal Farm Loan Act, Warehouse Act. It helped them with their crops, helped them make money. Then, also, he was doing exactly what he had promised, reducing tariffs. He wasn't really going back on his word, unlike Taft. He was trusted by the people, improved situation for the sailors with the La Follette Seamen's, what was it? Seamen's,
La Follette Seamen's Act.
Yeah, that was there. But one of the things to keep in mind was he wasn't pleasing everyone. Big businesses obviously did not like him because he was getting rid of them. Obviously, if people are destroying your money income, then you're not going to like him. And on these social issues, he wasn't a big player. He didn't really deal much with women's rights or issues with, like, segregation or the treatment of blacks. Didn't play a big part in that. And looking at the things that we have to know, we've discussed every single one of those so far, so if you can rewind, you can review those. But one of the ones that we probably haven't covered is Louis D. Brandeis.
And you also didn't cover the Adamson Act.
Oh, did we not? Okay. So Louis D. Brandeis was the Associate Justice.
Brandeis.
He was the Associate Justice at the time. I'm not sure if he was a really big player, but he definitely impacted Wilson's decisions.
And he was the first Jewish.
Yeah.
And there's a big university named after him.
Yeah. So the Adamson Act, which I thought I covered, maybe we didn't. So that was where the interstate commerce was, like, you get to work for 8 hours and you get paid if you work extra. I think we did cover that. Like the overtime, get paid more money. If you work, you only have to work 8 hours if you work interstate commerce. Also, I'd like to give a shout out to Emily Wang, who isn't actually an A-push, but she's still watching this, so she can get ahead and do better than her peers. We always like to enforce the competitive spirit here at Swag Test Prep. Okay, that takes care of that question.
Should I cover New Directions in Foreign Policy?
Yeah.
All right, Wilson's idea of foreign policy, his ideal was moralistic, which is do the right thing, and then people will go to respect America and our influence, and also make more friends. That should be the goal. And that's in stark contrast to both Taft-dollar diplomacy, and the reason why Wilson didn't want to continue with dollar diplomacy is because he did not trust Wall Street, because it's a whole corporate atmosphere, and the reason why he didn't want to do big stick diplomacy like Roosevelt is because it would make more enemies than friends, and his moralistic diplomacy was all about making friends. However, there were some contradictions, especially in the Caribbean, where he relied more on Roosevelt tactics, but one can argue that these were out of necessity because they were to protect American interests. For example, in Haiti, the president was killed, and there was a massive uprising there. So Roosevelt sent in the troops, the Marines into Haiti, to protect American interests, which goes against his policy, but then again, yes, it was a necessary evil. Same with the purchase of Virgin Islands. He didn't like imperialism, but he did it anyway because Denmark owned the Virgin Islands, and Germany was threatening to take over Denmark, and he thought that if they took over Denmark, they could also get a handle of Virgin Island, which would bring the war closer to America, which he didn't want to do. So that's the new directions in foreign policy and why Wilson's policies were different. Rahul, do you want to talk about Mexico?
Yeah, just before that, did you talk about like each of the 5 points that Mr. Melvin had outlined, like individually, like getting rid of dollar diplomacy, like the
Penn Not in the exact order, but I pretty much covered
Jones Act. Did you talk about the Jones Act?
I pretty much covered the same topics.
Okay, and then did you mention like contradictions and such?
Yeah.
All right. Perfect. Okay. So let's go to moralistic diplomacy in Mexico. This sort of gets a bit complicated. It requires a lot of attention. So just make sure you're listening.
Take your 5-hour energy now.
Yeah. One second. Let me just respond to this question real quick.
So while we're holding that, I'll just start with the origin. The basic origin was there's a revolution in Mexico where they overthrew a bad president and put in a new popular revolutionary one, but then a small group of Mexicans murdered the popular one and replaced him with the evil dictator Victoriano Huerta, who Wilson absolutely hated and thought Mexico should replace with a better president.
All right, so I'm going to break this down really quickly. So there was a bad leader in Mexico. Obviously, Mexican people did not like him. He was overthrown by the Mexicans. I'm pretty sure he was killed, but that doesn't really matter. He was just overthrown. They put in a good leader that they thought that would represent them as a people. But then the supporters of the old bad leader, they get mad, and they kill this new good leader. Once they kill this new leader, there's two important people, Carranza and Villa. They both are mad that the good leader was now killed, and they kill the new bad leader that took over the new good leader's position. So that's pretty
common. And that's Huerta, by the way.
Yeah, the bad leader, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they kill Huerta, and Carranza becomes the new leader. Obviously, when you have a partner and your partner does something better than you, you're jealous. So Villa gets jealous of Carranza. This, as you can see, is going to lead to some hostile sort of condition. And America sort of gets involved. They give weapons. Wilson gives Mexico weapons in order to help them with their revolution during this time. And after Carranza kills the new bad leader and takes over. Villa, since he's jealous, he starts to like stir up the American population. I'm pretty sure he kills a bunch of engineers on a train around the Texas area.
It was in New Mexico.
New Mexico, yeah. So he kills those people. Obviously, America's angry. Villa's purpose is enraging America, so they take over and kill Carranza. It's important to keep in mind that Carranza and Villa used to be friends. They both worked together to overtake Huerta, but
it's kind of a weird plan to try to kill someone, but
yeah. So
whatever.
Like,
he thought it was effective.
You sort of like enrage someone else, so they do the killing for you. But America doesn't really get mad at Carranza; they get mad at Villa. America Wilson sends one of the important leaders to chase after Villa, but they never find Villa during that chase, and they sort of come back empty-handed. And then eventually Villa, he just dies, irrelevant to this little topic. But it's important to keep in mind that there was a lot of like back and forth between the Mexicans, Mexican people, Mexican leaders, and then America, since we're like connected to Mexico, we get involved, Wilson gets involved, and Wilson like donates weapons to the Mexican people in order to help them with this effort. This incident is known as the Tampico incident. Yeah, so that's just what the whole sequence of events is referred to as. So this brings us into the start of the World War I. Josh, you want to talk about central powers? Before we get into that, let's talk about the ABC powers. The ABC powers were Argentina, Brazil, and Chile. They were South American countries. They played a big role because they sort of, I think what they did was they distracted America from like World War One, so it sort of turned their attention elsewhere and kept them out of the war for a little bit longer.
They had to do with Mexico, and they volunteered to mediate their issues in Mexico, and they're part of the reason why the United States eventually didn't go into full-out war with Mexico. The other reason is because of the threat of war in Germany, which is because of the thunder across the sea. So basically what happens was the Serbian patriot country, Serbia, kills Austria-Hungarian heir to the throne. This gets them angry, and then Germany gets mad because they're allies with Austria-Hungary, and then before you know it, all these countries, and then before you know it, like, Germany's like, oh, we're gonna invade France because we're angry because our heir died, and then Russia's like, oh no, we like France, and then Germany just decides to invade neutral Belgium, which turned a lot of people against Germany, and then England's like, oh no, this friend's our interest. So before you knew it, pretty much all of Europe was involved on one side or the other, all over this killing. And the central powers were Germany and Austria-Hungary. There are other people or other countries, but they're the central ones. They're the main powers. And the main allied powers were France, Russia, and England. We eventually joined on the side of the allied powers. But want to talk about our neutrality?
Okay, so number 11, what caused an officially neutral America to turn against the central powers? One of the things was that a German operative left his briefcase on an elevated car, I think in New York, and when this was recovered, people read it, and it was planned for a industrial sabotage. These plans were publicized, obviously making America mad at Germany, and America was already in some heat with Germany because of all like the boat problems and like the U-boats, how Germany was impacting American ships, other ships overseas, killing innocent Americans, destroying shipments. That sort of added to their anger, and then they slowly became from neutral to joining the Allies.
Or leaning towards the Allies.
Leaning towards the Allies, eventually to join the Allies. But I'm going to go right into... the no that you have to know for this is his name's Kaiser Wilhelm II. He was a leader...
Wilhelm.
He was a leader of Germany at the time, and sort of the disagreement Wilson had was with him personally. They didn't like each other, couldn't cooperate. Wilson was bad at cooperating, as we already know, couldn't work together, therefore it led to problems. So going right into like the next question, which was Germany's U.S. use of submarines, how did that affect situations with the U.S.? So there were three specific incidents. First was the Lusitania, which was a American ship. Second was the Arabic, and third was the Sussex. Sussex was a French merchant ship, I'm pretty sure. And these three sort of each progressively led to more anger of America with Germany. So starting off with the Lusitania, the first one, it was shot down by, it was torpedoed by German U-boats, killed, I think, 120? I think it was more, right? Do you remember how many people were killed in the Lusitania? How many Americans, Josh?
I think it was about 120.
Maybe. Yeah, somewhere around that. Bottom line, Americans died. Obviously, Wilson is mad. He tries to settle things down with Germany. Doesn't really go anywhere. Then came the Arabic, another ship that was shot down by German torpedoes from their submarine or U-boats. And obviously makes America more mad, even if it didn't really have to do with them. They got mad because innocent people were being killed. Then lastly comes the Sussex. It was another American merchant ship, which, not American, I'm pretty sure it was French merchant ship, right, Josh?
Yeah.
And it was torpedoed by Germany yet again. Obviously, at this point, three incidents. Wilson is pretty mad. Wilson is mad. Therefore, he tries to come up with, like, the Sussex Pledge, right? This is not a formal written document. It's more of a verbal agreement that he has with Germany that says that they are not going to attack American ships if there is no, like, threat of war, because this would prevent the death of multiple civilians that weren't really, like, playing a part in the war. And even though this Sussex Pledge was there, it wasn't very formal, so it wasn't really very enforced. Germany continued their malicious practices, and therefore America eventually sided with the Allies against Germany and then joined World War I. They were sort of like drawn into the war. It wasn't really started by them at all. They were just tugged in. Another reason why they joined the Allies, I think Josh mentioned this before, was that Britain and America had invested a lot of money in Britain's war efforts. So, obviously, they would side with America.
All right, so I'll just finish this up with the last two sections. A re-election in 1916 was a very close election between Wilson and Charles Evans Hughes. The main reason why Wilson won is because he narrowly won the vote in California. I think he only won by 3,000 votes there, and that shifted the electoral vote in favor for Wilson. So it wasn't a blowout. And his major slogan was he kept us out of war, because he did, which is kind of ironic because less than a year later, he led us into war. And the keys to his victory, won California. And Midwesterners and Westerners being attached to him because he did well on those fronts. It was the Northeast where Charles Evan Hughes made a lot of gains. The only states besides the Northeast where Charles Evan Hughes won were Oregon and Wisconsin, which is odd because those are very progressive states and Wilson is progressive. But varying viewpoints, this is basically showing that many people have varying views on exactly what defines progressivism. The New Left historians basically said that business leaders have the power, and that what defined them. It was the business leaders. Richard Hofstadter said it was from the middle class. So that's the argument. Not terribly important, but there it is.
Did you talk about Charles Evan Hughes, Josh?
Yeah.
All right.
As he lost to it.
Yeah, so basically what it comes down to is Wilson did do a good job as he wanted to, and he had said before, right after he was elected the first time, was that he needed to do amazing the first term to be reelected. He wanted to be reelected. He was reelected. It's important to keep in mind that Roosevelt did not run against Wilson again for the second election. I guess he was,
worn out.
Yeah, he accepted defeat, and he didn't really want to get involved again. He went back to, hunting in Africa.
And he probably had more fun.
He probably did. Basically, that's it. Let's see if we missed anything. So at this point, if you have any questions, you can just message them to us.
We're going to stay open for a little bit, ask questions, anything about anyone, not Miley Cyrus.
Yeah.
History's cool.
Oh. Yeah.
Oh. Also, congratulations to Mr. Melvin on the birth of Ethan Melvin on Sunday, was it?
I think it was Sunday. Let me check his Twitter.
Yes, so congratulations to Mr. Melvin on Ethan Melvin's birth.
Yeah, I can't find him. Hold on. there it is. Okay, so
baby Ethan Melvin born on
October 14th.
So that's Monday. A week from Monday, right?
I think it was Sunday.
No. You're wrong. It's a week from Monday. Or a week past Monday. Born in the morning at 10.
Wasn't he in school on Monday, though?
No, that was Tuesday.
Oh, okay. Yeah, maybe you're right.
Yeah, born in the morning at 10:25. 6 pounds, 10 ounces.
10 ounces. Yep.
You'll be seeing him someday. Of a bright future. Right now he's just a blank Word document. Alright, so if you don't have any questions, we're gonna wrap up in a minute or two.
Yeah, just message us. Literally, if you're watching right now, I know there's a lot of people watching. I can see the view count. Just message us. Let us know what you thought. If you think we did well, we'll share your comments with everybody.
All right, I'm just looking at the
is there a comment feed.
Ashlyn Hartman, to answer your question, we're wrapping up soon. And Salmon Ling asked to assess the validity of the following statement. The federal government of the United States passed policy and judgment during the years 1865 to 1900 in favor of business that had detrimental effect to individuals and consumers while having little economic benefit to the nation. I disagree with that statement because it did have a lot of economic benefits to the nation, increased our GDP tremendously. It brought us from an isolation nation to a major world power. However, these gains did have consequences as it led to problems in the city, which the progressive movement tried to correct and actually did a fairly successful job at correcting. All right, are we good? Are we chill?
Let's see. Oh, shout out to Gordon Chu for being one of the loyal viewers. Side note, Swag Test Prep's going to be expanding to two subjects that we are aware of right now, one of which is computer science. So if you're taking AP Comp Sci or just want to learn about Java or any other coding language, that will be opening up. Right now the target is end of November, maybe beginning of November, like December, that time. Also, we're going to be expanding to calculus. Calculus is going to also be in effect around the same time period. So if you're interested in those subjects or know anyone
who is that
would be benefited by those broadcasts, please let us know. Tell them. Subscribe to our channel. Just follow us on Twitter at Swag Test Prep. And by doing this, we hope to improve your grades, whether or not you're struggling. Doesn't really matter. Just by watching, you will definitely be helped. Okay, so here's a serious question from Mr. Tommy Zan. So Tommy's wondering what sort of free responses might be on the test. So what I'm pretty sure Mr. Melvin said, the free response is going to be similar to what we had on the last test, which was like assessing primary
schools. A little bit more DBQ oriented.
Yeah, we did that whole lesson on DBQs, so I'm pretty sure it's going to be him giving us a bunch of primary source documents. Don't worry, you're not going to have to write a full-length essay about like a bunch of like documents, but it's definitely going to be where you're going to have to analyze what someone is saying within a document, and based on that, come up with some sort of conjecture or some sort of statement or thesis or a general overview idea about what is being being said. Hopefully that answers your question. So if you have anything more about free response, you can just follow up, ask us.
All right, I think that concludes tonight's broadcast.
Yeah, so. I'm just going to wait, see if Tommy has any follow-up questions. If he doesn't, then we'll end it.
Remember, send this link to your friends, tell them to watch it.
Yeah.
Much enjoyable.
Eventually, I think we're going to be doing something that creates like initiative for students to watch our videos. I don't know what it's going to be, maybe some sort of prize or something if you subscribe, watch, tweet, whatever. But eventually in the future, we're going to be doing something specifically so that we get a lot of people to watch it and a lot of people to be influenced. All right, I think Tommy Zhang is fine. She says thank you. I think he enjoyed this. Hopefully he's watching for the whole time. But if there are no other questions, we will formally end this broadcast. We hope we helped you. This is very important because we did not actually, in class, like we didn't actually cover the entire packet because Mr. Melvin was absent. So I'm pretty sure this broadcast really helped some people that were unaware about that last page. If it did, you can let us know. You can tweet at us. But at this point, looks like we are done.
Good night.
Yeah. Thanks to everyone that watched us. And yeah.
We are done.
Swag test prep over and out.